Americans are fatter than they used to be. Part of the problem is the change from an active to a more sedentary society. Part of it may actually be addiction.
At some level, the body wants to give that pleasure over and over and over. Just like addiction to alcohol, addiction to nicotine, food became an addiction.
According to many experts, the problem is worse in Oklahoma than elsewhere.
If we had the same age-adjusted death rate as the United States, given our 3.5 million people, we would have 4,200 fewer deaths every year. It is the equivalent of a bombing of a Murrah building every 2 weeks.
There are some bright spots, employers actively promoting worker wellness, new techniques, even surgeries for controlling weight, but they are a drop in the proverbial bucket. On this edition of Stateline, our obesity epidemic.
It turns out that the United States is the fattest country in the world. 60% plus of our people in the United States are either overweight or obese. And then we get down to Oklahoma and we are fatter than the rest of the country as a whole. We have higher obesity rates. It has just crescendo. It's become like an epidemic.
No one wants to say, I am obese or I was obese, but, you know, I mean, it is a fact of life. You will not find a lot of pictures of me at 322, okay? I would not let it happen. You know, I would not be in the picture. I would be behind the camera taking the picture.
I'd gain weight and I'd lose it. I'd gain weight and I'd lose it. And then once I started getting more into my 40s, it was much harder to lose anything, you know. I just sort of steadily put on 10 pounds a year, you know, and then maybe or every couple of years. And I just noticed in my 40s over that 10-year span that every year I was putting on and not losing it the next year. It was a steady putting on 10 to where I was gaining like 30 pounds, you know, and not getting it off. And that was real depressing.
Meet Tom and Cindy Michaud, active and trim before marriage and waging the battle of the bulge ever since. But they aren't fighting alone. More than 60% of Americans are overweight or obese, making the United States the fattest country in the world. Oklahoma's percentages are even higher. Today, obesity is no longer categorized as a condition, but a disease. Oklahoma doctors call it an epidemic and say the only cure is wide-scale societal change.
Oklahoma County has a health status worse than the state as a whole. Yes. That's hard for even, you know, the Chamber of Commerce to believe and what have you, but it's true. Do you know that Oklahoma has the highest per capita presence of fast food eating establishments in the United States? We're 50th in the United States. We have the worst incidence of cardiovascular disease. We're on the bottom. And obesity encourages cardiovascular disease. It encourages diabetes, encourages stroke. It encourages certain kinds of cancer. It encourages kidney disease. It encourages one of the most disabling diseases that isn't talked about very much is osteoarthritis. And that makes sense if you think about it. So here's this whole list of chronic diseases that is encouraged by obesity. We can turn this whole obesity thing around. But it's going to be mainly, in my view, looking at how you affect the culture, the whole culture, rather than trying to just say, okay, we're going to educate individuals on how to eat right. That's important too, but that's not enough.
I tried many different plans, tried diet and exercise, and then you just give up for a while and accept the way you are.
The Michauds have battled weight gain for 32 years, the length of time they've been married. But that gain might have more to do with rapid societal changes that have taken place over that same time span than with the state of marriage itself.
As late as 1976, only 15% of our population had overweight and obesity. Today, is crossing 65% and going even higher.
Psychiatrist Dr. Murali Krishna has counseled many overweight patients.
We're not sweating out in the fields as much as we did before. We were an agricultural nation that depended on our muscle power. Now only a small percentage of population, very small, teeny percentage of the population support the agriculture. The rest of us are doing a lot more desk jobs.
Oklahoma Farm Bureau President Steve Copeland is a literal example of how such a career change can affect weight. He says that since he left his ranch to sit at a desk, he's gained 50 pounds.
When I return to my farm and ranch, I'm sure I'll spend more days out working, and hopefully I will lose a little of this weight that I've acquired through my years here at Oklahoma Farm Bureau.
These women work together. All have struggled with weight issues their entire lives, or rather, they've fought their love for and dependence on food.
I'm a stress eater. The more stress I have in my life, the more I want to eat. If I watch an OU football game on TV, I am constantly eating throughout the entire game.
Obesity today is a very complex issue. There are many things that we know that contribute to obesity, and a lot of it has to do, I think, with surplus and access. When we look 30 or 40 years ago, when Coke was, a nice treat for people or for children, and a large serving of Coke is 12 ounces 40 years ago. Well, today, a large serving of Coke may be 42 or 44 or sometimes even larger.
They make it easy, perhaps, to supersize everything.
When you're going through the fast food places, you say, I just want a sandwich and a diet soda, and they go, well, do you want to make that a combo?
We have so many more calories than our body could ever use that we are consuming. And society, the restaurant industry became like an entertainment industry.
Okay, so it's an extra long Philly cheesesteak.
Yep.
How do you know it's an extra long Philly cheesesteak?
Extra long Philly cheesesteak.
They sell you on the taste and the convenience and the quickness factor, as opposed to the nutritional value, as opposed to the quality of the food that your body needs.
You go to a restaurant and you get a large plate of food and you think, what a great value. But the converse is, what a waste of calories and energy surplus that in the long run can have a harmful effect. I think we still live in that, a little bit in that era of clean your plate. And when the portion size becomes twice what it was before and we're still trying to clean our plates, it certainly has an impact.
Many believe a lack of individual willpower is to blame for obesity. Others blame the restaurant and fast food industry, but a new medical finding has revealed yet another factor.
There have been hormones that have been identified that suggest once you reach a point of obesity, your body switches in a conservation mode. So even with attempts at reduction of calories and increase in activity level, it's much, much more difficult for people to lose weight because their body is trying to hold on.
It resists insulin, which is why obesity and type 2 diabetes often go together. We may come back to that. But it's also a chemical that affects an area in the brain, so then when I reach a certain level, my eating becomes like an addiction. And when it becomes like an addiction, it is as difficult to deal with as any other kind of addiction, whether it's nicotine addiction or morphine addiction or you name it. And so it isn't enough to have willpower. I have to put myself into a strategy, into a support system that helps me overcome an addiction. As opposed to saying, oh, what's wrong with me? Why am I so fat? See, that's what our culture tells our obese people to do, to blame themselves. As opposed to saying, the potency of the surround that has led to this obesity in the first place.
This finding could make a world of difference to those who face the repeated sting of weight loss failure.
You get depressed and you want to look better and you want to feel better. You know, you want to, you don't want your knees to hurt, you don't want your back to hurt, you want to be able to get out all the time and socialize, and that would keep you at home too, because you don't want to socialize, you don't feel like you look good. I would get depressed, but then I would just talk myself out of it and try to go on and just be happy with, you know, the way you are. But it, you know, it's just a cycle. You just go in a cycle of trying hard and then letting up.
I would be lying if I say that I wasn't embarrassed by my weight. I was. It's a burden on you emotionally. It's a burden on you mentally, because you know it's always there. You know, you actually try and joke it away. You know, I would make up jokes about my weight to get that off the table, so no one else had to do it.
When I make comments to audiences about obesity, the fat people in the audience laugh, and the psychiatrist in me says the reason they laugh is that if they laugh first, they kind of protect themselves from being ridiculed. Because our culture does ridicule individuals, some to be behind their backs, especially if they're obese and not merely overweight.
Our society is so geared towards physical appearance, and we are cruel to people who are overweight and who are obese. It's not something that they can hide.
You become invisible. I notice that when I would go to the mall or just walk across the parking lot, you're not seen. It's hard to describe it. You're just absolutely not seen by anyone.
No, I know exactly how you feel.
Yeah.
She's right.
But once you start losing weight, all of a sudden it's okay to meet people straight on in their eyes.
And I think people that are overweight, they use it as they're kind of ashamed about it. I think you tend to kind of hide in it.
Of the obese, only 5 to 10% are successful losing weight through diet and exercise. Being overweight and being obese are two different things. You can find out if you are in either category by checking your BMI or body mass index online. If you are not obese but simply overweight, you might think you will be spared any hormonal problems. But doctors say you likely already have a monkey on your back, a large one that could push you across the line into obesity.
When you get pleasure out of an activity, at some level, the body wants to give that pleasure over and over and over. Just like addiction to alcohol, addiction to nicotine, food became an addiction. When the pleasure is coming out of it, the same pleasure pathways crave for more and more and more. You know, and then there's a brain mechanism whereby you crave for the food. That's one of the reasons why we crave for carbohydrates, you know, the refined carbohydrates and sugars, because they give the biggest buzz you can have.
Individuals who are obese or overweight often are willing to say, you know, I'm eat even though I don't feel hungry. Now, there's a different part of the brain that regulates food intake in terms of hunger. But if I am not happy for whatever reason, if I suffer from depression, I can then, without thinking about it, attempt to deal with my grief, my sadness, my unhappiness by eating, because it affects the same part of the brain that resonates when two people are really enjoying each other. Much of what I'm saying about the brain has only been verified in the past 5 years by the brain imaging studies that are now available. And so many health professionals don't even know the connection, are kind of shocked when I, for example, talk about obesity as being a calorie addiction.
They may not have known about the odds stacked against them, but those who shared their stories with us say they did know one thing.
They had to do something about their weight.
I was very, very apprehensive about turning 60 and being in a position where I would not be able to address the issues of health like I wanted to.
I had gotten to the point where my cholesterol was too high, my blood sugar was too high, my blood pressure was too high. I had all of the risk symptoms that a certain age bring, well, not just age, but weight.
My knees were hurting and my lower back was hurting and I just didn't have any energy. So it was, and I wanted to be around when my daughter was 40 and 50, and I knew if I didn't make some changes in my life, I wouldn't be.
I have an incentive to consistently work out. Before, I'll make a goal to work out and I'll follow it for about a week or two and then I would stop. While I've been at Cardinal, I've been doing it consistently for the entire 6 to 8 weeks that I've been here, which has really improved my health.
Meet Constance Barris. She's part of a relatively new trend in corporate Oklahoma. Businesses are enlisting in the Battle of the Bulge on behalf of their employees.
I think a healthy person, a successful employee, and a successful parent are related.
Steve Mason is the president of Cardinal Engineering. 8 years ago, he decided to create a health incentive plan for his employees.
Well, initially I thought, well, if we do this, it'll lower our health insurance premiums. And then I learned that there's a federal law to prevent discrimination against companies. So our health insurance rates are based on a pool of small businesses. So the effect on my insurance rates is actually very small. But that was one of the reasons why we started. And the other reason was just kind of the right thing to do is if you look at a person as the whole person.
Under Cardinal's incentive program, employees set reasonable goals to improve their health and a plan to achieve that goal. For every 3 months they execute their plan, they get paid $300. That's important to this single mother of two.
The money was a really big plus. By December the 1st, if we followed our health incentive program for 3 months, we'll get it for December the 1st in time for Christmas. So that really, I was really overjoyed.
Like chocolate.
If she stays on plan all year, Constance will earn a total of $1,200 for sticking to her exercise routine.
I have healthier employees. We don't have many sick days. They're generally in pretty good moods. And if you look at the claims we have on our health insurance, they're more catastrophic. They're from auto accidents. They're from cancer, which are very hard to control. But if you look at our claims because of we had to work on someone's knee because they're too heavy, or heart problems here at Cardinal, I can't think of a single heart problem we've had. I can't think of a single knee that had to be rebuilt because the person was overweight and didn't get any exercise.
Things are different than 10 or 15 years ago in the leadership and the corporations who become more and more aware of health status and what it costs them in dollars to have obese and overweight workforce. And so I'm more optimistic about our being able to have an impact on this than I would have been 10 or 15 years ago.
Cardinal Engineering won the 2005 Blue Cross Blue Shield Champions of Health Award, proving that employers don't have to give workers gymnasiums to make a difference in everyone's bottom line.
Because then you admit that you were overweight to begin with.
The ladies who work together all happen to work for a large hospital. They lost weight when that hospital adopted a program for overweight employees.
I mean, the motivation has to be there, but you need the opportunity to take that first step. And that was what was provided at our office. They started a Weight Watchers at Work program.
Corporate programs are optional, and not all employees take advantage.
I have not been able to take full advantage of the program because of time constraints with children. I've got two children, and often when I get home, it's hard to find time to work out or walk or to run races or whatever. I try and work out during lunch, and since this is an incentive for everyone in the company, it's generally easy to find someone else that wants to walk with me as well.
I can promise you that if you walk three lunches a week and then come home and come back and have a small lunch at your desk, you've consumed fewer calories and you've expended them walking. So I think what we're doing isn't rocket science.
It's about making little changes that are going to have an effect over the long term, and whether that's making a commitment to getting out and move.
Getting out to move in Oklahoma presents another challenge.
Oklahomans are actually more inactive physically than the United States as a whole. Oklahoma is not built to walk. It's built to drive a car to go anywhere. There are often no sidewalks to walk on. It's a culture that speaks to inactivity.
We spend a lot of time in Utah, and there's a lot of outdoor opportunities in Utah. I think in Oklahoma, we get a lot of outdoor opportunities, I think, from our hunting and fishing, but we don't have particularly an outdoor culture, I think.
I spent several years in Columbus for a while. They were one of the heaviest cities in the nation, and they recognized it as a problem and began to try and find ways as a community to promote fitness and activity.
And so I opened up the Chamber of Commerce's goals, and number three was to improve the health of their...
Nothing on Oklahoma. The State Department of Health has initiated a program to promote healthier lifestyles. It's called Turning Point.
Our health statistics in Oklahoma, as you know, are terrible. And in fact, our death rates since 1988 have actually increased. We're the only state in the nation where age-adjusted death rates have increased, where the rest of the nation has decreased. We do have a large percentage of our population who are overweight. Part of the reason is because we don't exercise very much here in Oklahoma. Well, Turning Point gives us an opportunity to really rethink public health. And instead of us telling communities what to do, it really flipped that. And we started working with communities, and they were telling us what their problems were, how those problems should be solved. They're developing walking trails. They're working with schools to implement healthy nutrition and healthy educational programs to get their kids to eat better. They're also trying to get their citizens to walk healthier. Through Turning Point, we have an initiative called Walk This Way. The way is spelled W-E-I-G-H. Mm-hmm. And we've had literally hundreds of people all across the state walk.
But sometimes the best programs, the best intentions, the best motivation in the world doesn't seem to help. The Michauds say they tried it all and still gained weight. In 2004, after 30 years of struggle, they decided to invest in surgery.
Both the surgery Cindy had, which was the lap band, and the surgery I had, which is the gastric bypass, are both just tools. Okay, they are not going to conquer this disease for us. They are tools to let us conquer the disease. We still have to have the discipline, though not as much.
We really don't have to shop as often because we don't eat as much. And, you know, every meal is only a half a cup of food because our stomach is so much smaller. Obviously, we steer toward the healthy food because it's what makes us feel better, and we've learned that because any kind of sugar and you know, things that are rich, you know, especially desserts or anything, you get a stomach ache, and that's not fun.
Tom lost 122 pounds. Cindy lost 50.
I don't think that with my body, my lifestyle, my habits, I don't think that if I had lost 100 pounds, I think I would gain it back, okay? Because that yo-yo, that up and down and up and down, had been going on for 30 years.
I just felt like that I just couldn't do it on my own. And I knew this would be a little help, and there was a lot of success with it, and I read up on it and found out a lot about it, and I knew that was what I wanted to try.
When Tom Michaud decided weight loss surgery was good enough for him, he decided it was good enough for his own corporation.
We have three surgical hospitals, we have some imaging centers, and we'll be opening our second bariatric hospital up, We have one in Oklahoma City. The second one will open up in San Antonio in January. And we'll have a third one open up in Houston, probably summer of next year.
While the Michauds believe surgery can work in extreme cases, they don't believe it should be applied across the board.
I don't care if you weigh 500 pounds, I cannot walk up to you and say, you need to have bariatric surgery. I can tell you, you need to get some information about bariatric surgery, about diet, exercise, all the tools available out there, because you do not want to go through life and develop the comorbidities that come with obesity.
There are many health problems related to obesity. There's more than 30 health conditions that are impacted directly by overweight and obesity, and most of those will improve with weight loss. And that's the encouraging thing, that there is hope, there is a chance for better health.
If we can do it, anybody can do it.
I will never go back to where I was.
Oklahomans are not alone in this growing problem. According to the Centers for Disease Control, obesity rates have risen nationwide over the last 20 years. 30% of the U.S. adult population, more than 60 million people, are overweight. And 16% of the nation's children are now thought to be affected by the obesity epidemic.
There you go.
For a VHS or DVD copy of this program, please send a check or money order for $22.95 to the OETA Foundation, Post Office Box 14190, Oklahoma City 73113. Or to place a credit card order, call 800-879-6382 during regular business hours.